I started in 81. I got a Raleigh Burner for Christmas, like everyone did just at that time. But I didn't really get into kind of freestyle BMX until about, I think it was about 82, end of 82. I was just obsessed by it. You know, it was like day and night, you know, just constant. If it was raining, I'd be riding in the garage doing flatland, you know, or in the house, just trying balancing tricks or whatever. Then I got sponsored through the local bike shop, and we did a lot of, like, you know, demos locally and stuff like that, you know, school fates and stuff like that. And I even did like an under 16s discos on a Monday night, and I was doing demos there in Carnarvon. Yeah, I mean, you know, I was that BMX boy, you know, I was that BMX kid, and at school, oh, you're still riding that bike, you know, get a lot of shit for it. It wasn't cool. It was definitely wasn't cool. And especially growing up in Wales, in a small village in Wales where everyone played football, rugby and cricket, and hanging out, that was it, you know. So I was definitely kind of like frowned upon. And even to when I was, you know, got in my 20s, and they go, you're still riding that bike, you know. It was still, that was early 90s, and people didn't really understand it. And I was trying to explain to them, well, look, you play football, I ride BMX. It's no different, you know. Right. My parents still don't understand it. They just don't understand it now. Like, my mum keeps, are you still riding that bike, Mum? It's my job. You know, it's what I do. You know, I'm like, I'm involved, I'm selling bikes. And you're like, oh, yeah, okay. I still don't understand it. I said, okay, it doesn't matter. Towards like 85, 86, it was definitely fading away. You know, the boom had gone, and then it's on its way out. And at that point, I was just left with maybe one rider, but he was mainly a skateboarder. It definitely took a toll on my riding, because I was no one to ride with. I wasn't motivated to ride. And back then, there was nowhere to ride either. In the early 90s, it started. They started building mini ramps, didn't they? Metal mini ramps everywhere. And then it kind of transitioned into street riding. I met Will and those guys and the Scottish guys up in Barrow and Furnace, one of those comps there. And I think that was probably 90, 91. And that's when, you know, that was kind of a big UK comp at the time. And then we just write letters, just back and forth and stuff like that. And he said, oh, I've got some footage, because I had a camera, because I'd film myself. And that's how Bold Iron came, because I said, oh, I've got a load of footage. And he said, you can have it if you want. I'm not going to use it. I'm just filming myself just to improve. And, you know, I wasn't planning on putting a video out or anything. At that point as well, I'd made friends with Harry and Chris Hamer and John Taylor. They had a shop in Manchester called Sheep. Every weekend then was me just traveling to Manchester or Chester to hang out and ride. I spent years doing that, just going back and forth. And we'd just go to different places. It wasn't just riding Manchester. John would say, let's go to Nottingham and go and ride Nottingham, and just all over the place, really. I met the people who thinks like me, like John Taylor and Harry and, you know, John Barnett, Kong and John Hall, those guys. It was just like, okay, where are we going this weekend? Where are we going next weekend? Oh, there's a park somewhere. Oh, Leon C's just opened up. We're going to go down there. You know, there's some jumps here. We'd go to those. It just happened, you know. It wasn't like it was easy, you know. I think it was just a natural thing. I know a place where the sun hits the sky. First came to Hastings in 89, hung up, stayed with Stuart, rode with Stuart and stuff like that, and then came back, you know, 90, 91, 92, and went to America broke my wrist on the first day I got there. And I came back, it's back in Wales, like really miserable. Like thinking, what, couldn't, you know, nothing to do, broken wrist. And Stu said, well, just move, come down to Hastings and stay for a bit. So I came down and eventually just stayed here, you know, just kind of like, there wasn't a plan to come to Hastings to like, okay, I'm gonna work with Stu and start, you know, get involved in the backyard jams or start 70s or anything. It just kind of happened naturally. It wasn't like, okay, we're gonna do this and this is the plan. It was just like, okay, sound good? Yeah, this feels good, let's do it. And yeah, and that's how it kind of, the whole move happened, you know. My first trip to America was 93, and that was my first contest in America as well. I didn't really know what to expect, you know, but Chris Moeller picked us up from the airport, and I was just like, okay, yeah, this is just mental. I remember being at Hoffman Bikes going, this is what I want to do. Like, this is just amazing. And I remember being there on a Thursday night watching Matt hit that big ramp, you know, with no one there, just like 20 people, just the people there for the contest. And I was just like, oh my God, this is just like, there's this guy who just does this, just does it for himself, doesn't care, you know. And just the fact they were just, that's all they did, you know. There was nothing else, you know, they didn't go for a job or anything. I want to do this, you know. So that was definitely life-changing, that trip. I guess by the circle of friends, I got coverage based on the fact that I kind of knew the guys from Dig, and then I was down in Hastings, and, you know, on the South Coast, it kind of happens a lot more than it does if you're up north. You know, you know, there's more photographers down here and stuff, and I kind of got in the magazines that way, because I think it was based on my skill level as an overall rider. It's like, oh, Ian can do that, he'll do that rail or whatever, and I'd get the photo in the mag, you know. My first cover was BMX Now, and I really like that one. I'm really proud of. And then when Dig came out, I was like, you know, and it kind of all kind of, then I got a lot of coverage, you know, in a short space of time, really. You know, BMX was changing a lot back then. Street was coming in, and then the whole, you know, handrails were kind of being experimented with as such. I definitely got coverage based on the fact that, okay, it was different than what else you were seeing at the time. Because BMX was evolving, wasn't it? It was changing a lot, you know, like, you know, uniforms were going, you know, everyone's wearing shorts and shin guards and knee pads and stuff. Yeah, I think so, yeah. I was here in Hastings, and we obviously, 70s needed an ad, they needed an S&M ad, and Ed Doherty lived here, you know, so it was like, you know, the riders that we sponsored or whatever didn't come through or whatever, I could go out and get something. That's what I did. It's like, okay, people give me stuff, so I'm just going to pay them back by, like, delivering. I'm not going to go, oh, I'm not sure. Yeah, I'm not sure if I can shoot that, or the weather's not right, or this is not right. I just go, nah, yeah, what do you need? You know, I owe you for it. So I think, yeah, I did, you know, okay, another picture of Ian doing a handrail, or, you know, another picture of Ian doing a toboggan or whatever. But it wasn't like, I wasn't searching for it. It just, I was at the right place, I guess, the right time, you know. Basically, you got just free parts, you know, and then, you know, rode for S&M forever, and it was just basically free parts. Probably got the odd plane ticket, you know, but what S&M taught me was, being sponsored by S&M was like going to California and staying with Chris And that's where I learned so much about the industry. Because I spend, you know, 2 or 3 weeks at a time with Chris, and not just a ride, we'd go to work every day. And I would just be there, just learning and seeing what he was doing. And it was really like, that helped me so much to kind of, to be able to do what I do now. First time I did it for the hell of it, stuck it around the back of my tongue and then swallowed it. Second time, things are getting easier, pull me down this way, it's getting busier. Third time lucky, made me feeling fuzzy. Oh my god, they're getting hippy dippy. 4, 6, 7, was an obsession, you know. I loved it. I just, you know, I started off just trying to figure it all out, because there wasn't YouTube. See, I don't know if I had done a rail before I had first come out or not. I'm not sure, but that definitely, Matt doing that big rail, and I was thinking, yeah, you know. And I just got every rail or flat rail or whatever, I'd look at it, think, see if I could grind it, you know. Especially when I moved to Hastings, and when Stu was riding, we would be every weekend, like it would be me and him in the car going looking for rails, you know, with a camera, and we'd film each other. Yeah, I think it was just, you know, it was just probably something inside me that kind of like, that was my outlet to kind of like scare myself, you know? And I like to scare myself and I like to push myself. And I just wanted to see what was possible really on a rail. Like, you know, how many rails can you do? You know, like how many stairs can you do? So, and then the roof gaps was just like, it was just, basically I was just searching for that thrill really, you know? Even though I could ride a ramp, I could do, you know, kind of all the just kind of basic tricks and ice pick, toothpick, whatever, nose picks, Canadian nose picks and stuff like that. So I was really into all that too, but you know, I'd have to kind of, I couldn't help myself. You know, that I had to push myself and do that and just scare myself. And most of the time it worked out, you know. I guess I had that reputation where like, okay, when you turn up at a contest or something, and is he gonna do something big? And that really put me off a bit. I didn't like riding in front of people either. That became more and more as I got older. I did get an invite to the X Games. I went to the one in Boston. It was the second or third X Games, I think it was, to ride dirt. And I basically, I think that I got that invite based on my coverage from the backyard jams. But those jumps were different. You know, they were just a tabletop. I was doing 360s, table threes, can-can threes and stuff. And I jumped the chasm and I had that picture of doing a toboggan over the chasm. And at the time, that was a big jump. But then I went to Rhode Island. It wasn't Rhode Island, it was Boston, sorry. And I saw the jumps and I went, that's no way I'm jumping these. You know, I'm not, the jumps are way bigger. They're basically, you know, same as the chasm of backyard. But three of them, or two of them, whatever it was at the time, and a big rolling, and that was like the one and only time I went to the X Games. And I think I must have hurt myself. I pretended to hurt myself or whatever, but I was like, I can't do this. And it was just, you know, it was everything I didn't like about BMX as well. Not like about it, that's the wrong word, but you know, you'd go there, you get your photo taken. It was very formal and, you know, structure and stuff. And I was like, I don't really like this, you know? I didn't feel comfortable. Not saying I don't like watching it and I'm not into it. It's fine. I'm not anti it or whatever, but it, I just felt like a bit, it's just not for me. And I stepped away from that. Every day and every night, and you'll never go away, 'cause I know you're here to stay for the rest of my life.
BMX was, I think BMX was at this lowest point at this time. There was nothing going on. And I think Stu did the first backyard, I think it was 91. By 92, it started to get bigger. I think it was 92, I think when McCoy came over, wasn't it? McCoy and Fuzzy. And that's when it like started to get, okay, there's something here, you know. That kind of really put it on the map, I think. That's what kind of took it to the next level. I think the golden years of them was like 92 to like 96, I think. That was when it was, but then it got out of control. You know, we had kids, you know, staying at camp in there, and it was just mayhem. It was just, it was scary, you know. My role was, Stu already started it, and it kind of grew naturally. It grew that, and Stu just needed help. And then I just started helping him doing it, you know, thinking of which rider to come over, booking flights, you know, picking them up from the airport. Building the jumps, you know, taking money at the door, you know, helping with getting the flyers done, and basically whatever it took, really. There wasn't, like, again, it was just really, really natural. It wasn't like a big plan, you know. We wanted to see those guys in the UK, you know. We wanted to see Hoffman riding the ramp. We wanted to see Chris Moeller jumping the jump. There was no, like, okay, we're going to put on this event, and then we're going to charge £2, and we're going to sell tons of product from it. That definitely was not the goal, you know. It was just like, okay, we're going to have put on an event, see some really good riding, and some of our favorite riders come over to the UK. And that was the whole, you know, that was the whole goal of it, really. I don't think we even had a budget. And there was no budget, yeah. We did get offered $5,000 from Diamondback to sponsor it, and it was couldn't be called the Diamondback Backyard Jam, but we couldn't do it. Stu couldn't do it. He said, nah. And I'm glad we didn't do it, but at the time, the $5,000 would have paid for everything, and you know, we would have probably made some money or whatever. But yeah, but I'm glad we didn't do it though, you know. But I think as well, thinking back on those, I think those backyard jams kind of opened the door for people, for places like NAS to make these festivals, because, you know, we had the whole lifestyle there, you know. It was a kind of the first festival vibe thing, you know, for BMX, you know. Really, we should have kept on. If you wanted to make a big business plan out of it, we could have probably kept it going and for years and years, and you know, took it to the next level and maybe make it an official kind of festival. But that wasn't the plan. That was just basically, we just wanted to see our favorite riders from America in the UK riding and just having a good time. All these guys are coming through, you know, like we had the boy Mike Ockerbot come over, you know, and then we had Sean Butler, Baspin Ryan, Marvin, all these guys, you know. It was just amazing because they were just like, you know, really first time out the country, you know. Like I remember Chris Bennett, I think he was I think he was 15, 16. And, you know, because we'd been drinking, and he wasn't drinking. He'd be driving the van around, from the jam back to Hastings. And he was like, you know, on the wrong side of the road. You know, and those guys, every time I go to California, I see Sean Butler or Baspin Ryan. They're just so thankful at that time because they just made a huge impact on themselves and on the people that come in the UK. You know, it was great. We weren't, I certainly, I know Stu certainly wasn't looking for credit. He just wanted to, you know, to do good stuff, you know, and do cool things. And I think, and deep down, you know, like the right people know that it was such a, I think, a pinnacle time in BMX. I think it was needed, you know, it was needed to keep it going and for BMX to kind of go through those lean it period to come back and reinvent itself. And that's what it did, you know. It became stressful, you know. You know, toilets were damaged and we had bills for that and put the fencing up. And it wasn't just 2 days, you know, it was basically a month, you know, of intense kind of, you know, it became, I guess it was just something, it became a job, I guess, maybe. It was work, basically 12 hours a day building jumps, you know, and you, when people see how many people come there and they see, okay, £2 a head, but people think you're making money, you know, so then everyone kind of wanted something for doing it. So then it kind of like, it just grew into a monster that it was, that we couldn't really manage, or wasn't into it. I said, we could have managed it and probably made it work, but we were like, not really into this. It's just become a pain in the ass, you know? And that's how we then took a year off, I think, and then we started the bike shows. Yeah, it was changing, and, you know, and it was changing, you know, a lot more. There was a lot more brands coming along that were ride around and stuff like that, and that kind of, it was definitely changing. And bike riding became a bit more polished, refined, I think, you know, like, yeah, there was a lot of that time where, you know, when you're doing Foof News on sub boxes and stuff and you pull 1 out of 10, but then Jerry and Joe and those guys were just pulling them, just starting to pull them all the time. So it kind of, it was just, BMX was kind of, okay, this is getting a lot more polished, I think. And yeah, that was a good time, I think. Left there 2006. So in that, you know, from when I started helping and working for Stu, 93, you know, we'd done the backyard jams, we started Federal, and it was all changing back then, you know, and there was almost like this new generation of people having bike companies. Everyone wanted a piece of 70s. We did a good job. We were a good distributor, you know, and everyone wanted, from America, every brand wanted to be, they were just like, if they started a brand over there, it would come straight to 70s. It was just like a no-brainer, because you get carried away. You're at Vegas and someone offers you a brand. Oh, yeah, okay, we'll take it. And next minute, that happens 2 or 3 times during the show, and then you picked up 3 new, 4 brands, you know? So, and I just kind of just got lost in the mix. Before that, you know, Boyle passed away, so that was really heavy. That was kind of at a grim time, you know. It was kind of like we'd moved into a bigger building, it was like huge, and it was just, okay, we've got to have a plan. It was business plans and budgets and stuff, and I wasn't into it anymore. Me and Stu didn't see eye to eye and stuff, and it wasn't that he did something wrong or I did anything wrong. I was just like, we've gone so far with this, you know, and I can't go any further with it, and I just like, okay, I've got to get on, do my own thing, you know. And that's how it happened, really. And it was done, it wasn't like this big major plan. It happened really quick, and within a month I was out, you know. It wasn't easy, it wasn't a nice split. It's cool now, you know, we're friends again, and it's like it's all in the past. Care of me. I mean, I can't thank him. You know, took care of me for years and years. You know, and I And it kind of helped me be who I am today. You know, without Stu, I would like probably be, I don't know where I'd be, you know. Well, the main objective was to start my own brand, United. So we needed a distribution, and then we got FBM and Bicycle Union and Animal. I think that was our first brand. But it wasn't like I'd kind of had this big master plan. I didn't know who was going to come and help be part of me. But all I needed somewhere to distribute United. I didn't know how it was going to go. You know, I started from my house. You know, I went backwards. You know, worked from my house. You know, I didn't think it'd get to the point where we are now, but I knew that, okay, I needed to do X amount a year to kind of maintain and pay the bills and everyone get paid. And that's kind of been always my goal, really. It's about living it, really, than actually selling it. So got to do the things I believe in, you know. And if you look at the four down brands, you know, they're all brands I believe in. There's not a brand there I'm not into, you know. And they're not put, you know, I'm really good friends with, you know, Joe Rich, Chris Moeller, Steve Crandall, Ralph Sinisi, you know, John Dye. You know, they're all my friends, and I believe in it. And I, you know, I believe in the brands, and they're the brands I want to represent in the UK. I wouldn't do this if I didn't ride. And I think if the day comes and I'm not riding anymore, I don't think I'd do this, because I couldn't be involved in something and not ride. And that's kind of probably the reason I'm still riding now, you know, because I just, if I wasn't involved, maybe would I ride as much? If I had a full-time job doing something else, I don't know, maybe not. Maybe it'd be once a week or once every other week, you know. But I have kind of, this has taken over my life, you know. Take me tonight, I'm an easy lover. Take me into the fire, I'm an easy brother. I ride as much as I can and go on trips with the guys as well. I haven't done much of that recently, just because, you know, that United as a brand is evolving. Now we've got the new breed of young riders coming in. So the brand's changing. So that's the reason I got a Fu Man in, to kind of run the brand on the kind of marketing side for me, because he can relate to him. You know, he's in his 20s. You know, I'm nearly 50. I'm 50 next year. You know, it's just like I can't be on a road with a bunch of 20-year-olds. Nothing. I like it, don't get me wrong, but it's just after a week, it's like, okay, get me out of here kind of thing. No, my diet's terrible. I'm really bad. I wish I could eat better, but I can't, you know. And fitness, I mean, I ride my bike as much as I can, running, road cycling, you know. But I feel good on a bike still. I don't feel like, you know, I'm not going to play that game like, oh yeah, I'm old. And I feel, actually feel pretty good on a bike. And I feel I enjoy it a lot more now than I've ever done, really, just because I don't care what people think. I don't care, you know, what other people think of my riding. I'm just like, okay, I'm just having a good time. I'm scared. I'm scared, but there's that switch there. Like I did it yesterday, I jumped into the bowl transfer. So the switch is definitely there, and, you know, I did a good handrail about two years ago in Glasgow. And yeah, it's definitely there, you know, and that scares me sometimes, because I can't control myself. And as long as it feels good, I'll keep on doing it, you know. I'm on fire. I'll be honest, I don't like modern day park riding. I just don't like it. I don't understand it. I just, it's something, like, I'm a big fan of it, like a good tabletop, you know? I like a good bar spin, but then, and a good tail whip, like anyone else. But when it becomes, you know, five tricks in one, I just like someone doing something different, I guess. But when they all kind of do the same stuff and at a park event, it just kind of, it's just not for me, you know? I do appreciate it. I can see how hard it is, someone doing a tail whip flare, 8 foot out, whatever. I get it, it's hard, but it just doesn't do anything for me. You know, and I'm not a bitter old school BMXer, you know? I can, you know, like modern day street, you know, with a free coaster and stuff, I can see and appreciate how difficult and good it is, but it's not for me. I don't like this technical tinkering on a foot tall ledge, you know? But it doesn't say that I hate it or just won't watch it, but it's just not for me, so. But there's, I mean, BMX has changed so much, you know? I mean, in the 90s and 2000s, you kind of knew all the pros. You knew who was a professional rider, but now I don't even know. And I'm involved in it on a daily basis. There's park riders there and go, I don't know half these guys, you know? I was like really insecure, kind of, you know, bullied at school, you know? And I was like, not because of the BMX thing, just in general. I mean, you know, back then, ginger hair at school, you just got it, you know? You just got it, like you were gonna get it. You got glasses, you were four eyes, and you're ginger and you're fat, you know? But that doesn't really exist anymore, I guess. I might do, I don't know. But then, so I was like always that kind of like, you know, guy in the background, really, just kind of, and then I'd go to school and then come home and ride my bike. But yeah, it's given me so much, you know, BMX has, and yeah, I couldn't be, I don't know where I'd be. I don't know where I'd be or whatever, but it's given me so much. And I don't forget it. I'm kind of like, I've always been, you know, on the thing that BMX owes me nothing. It's given me like an endless kind of summer school holiday. I feel like it. Like today, you know, you coming down, we rode, and that's like, it happens a lot. This is what I want to do, and I'm going to continue to do this until I don't want to get a real job. Not my age.